Hi, welcome to this presentation on our new course on automatic power factor correction. Today, together, we will have a look at the new course content that comes with this new course, the modules that are required, the various features and functions that will be covered in this course, and the various topics that you will be able to teach using this this new course. So let's start by having a look at our manual, the table of contents in the manual, so you have a better understanding on what we are talking about. So in this new course, there will be many topics that will be covered. But first, let's have a look at where in our course structure this new course fits. So as you can see, it is a part of the course structure that comes with our electromechanical training system, the version 8010-9, which comprises the course on the power circuits and the rotating machines, single phase and three phase rotating machines, and power factor correction. So just following this, we add this topic on automatic power factor correction, which will be presented here. So let's start by having a look at the topics covered in the course by looking at the table of contents here. So we will start with an introduction, which will discuss the diagrams of these systems, the electricity billing practices, how to determine the size and configuration of a system, using Y or delta connected capacitor banks, harmonic distortion. This is the introduction. Then in the first exercise, we will learn how to commission an APFC system, as we can see here, how to do the connections, how to configure the parameters, the resolution of the power factor correction that is achieved, and determining the power factor value targeted for specific applications. The second exercise will be about capacitor bank switching and current transients. So capacitor contactors, discharge resistors, configuration parameters related to capacitor bank switching, control delays, and we will have an exercise on this, hands-on exercise. The third exercise will be about capacitor bank switching control. So the configuration parameters of the PF controller related to capacitor bank switching, the modes that are available in the Festo power factor controller module, and then we will have the hands-on exercise on this, followed by appendices. Okay, so let's now have a look at the content of the course on our platform, LX, which shows the course in electronic format. So here we will be able to navigate to the procedure for the first exercise, which was about commissioning an APFC system. So let's jump to the procedure outline. So for those of you familiar with our course structures and our procedure, detailed procedures, you will see that we have the same approach here with this course. Of course, really detailed step-by-step approach for the student to follow and complete the exercise. Of course, with all the required accompanying schematics. So here is the schematic of the system that we want the student to wire. So quickly here we can see that from our three-phase power source, from the three-phase power source, we will connect our power factor controller, the capacitor banks of which will be connected on the next page to, as we can see, the capacitor banks themselves and the contactors that will allow us to trigger on or off each of these capacitor banks. And finally, on the far right, we will be connecting to a resistive and inductive load so that we can change the value of this load and see how the automatic power factor correction is applied. So now let's go back to the system itself, having a look at the connections and testing the system. So now let's have a look at the connections corresponding to the schematics we just saw in our electronic course. So starting from our three-phase power supply down here, we simply go all the way up to our capacitor bank here. But also, we go first through our data acquisition module to be able to measure the voltage and current on the source side of our system. Then we do all the connections to the power factor controller module itself. So for to do its job, it needs to have the voltage on one of the phase of our system, the current, of course, to be able to measure the phase shift between the two, and it also needs to be powered, so it needs its own power input. Then for the control portion of things, of course, the controller needs to be connected to capacitor banks. So we have here on the right the power factor control capacitor bank module, which, as you can see, comprises four different banks of capacitors connected in a delta configuration. In the course, we explain why we decided to go with a delta connection. So each of these banks, when they will come on, will have a LED lit here to show that it is currently connected in parallel with the circuit. To be able to insert these banks or take them out of the circuit, we have here the contactors that will be powered by the power factor correction module here. So that's why we connect the output contacts here of this controller directly here to these contactors that will insert or not the capacitor. We also have on this module the current transformer. As you know, all these systems have current transformers to be able to step down the currents on the system to be protected at levels that are easier to manage. So typically it would be a 1000 amp to 5 amp current transformer. In our case, of course, we work at low voltage and low current, so we have a 2.5 to 5 amp current transformer here, the output of which is used to as an input to our power quality controller. Finally, on the right side of our power factor correction capacitor banks, we have the three-phase line powering our three-phase load here. So you can see that we have used a resistive and inductive loads, inductive load modules that are connected in parallel, so that we will be able to control the amount of active and reactive power we consume at any given moment and see how the controller responds to these changes. So initially we start with a purely resistive load. So I have currently 600 ohms on each of my lines. And we can see here on the power factor controller module that it reads a power factor of 1, of course, purely resistive. The cap indication here says that it is capacitive or inductive when we have a power factor that is different than unity, but it stays at the last value that was used. So, and we can also see at the bottom here that the system knows that it is connected to four capacitor banks, and that for the moment none of them is active. We will see in a moment how it appears when one of the banks becomes active. So on this display mode with the arrows, we have access to different data. So we have access to the current coming in. So of course you understand that we do not have a 200 amp flowing in this system. The reason the controller thinks that it's 200 amp is because we have configured it to specified in its parameters that the current transformer to which it is connected is a 2500 amp to 5 amp, while in case it is a 2.5 to 5 amp. So it multiplies all of the currents coming in by 1000, and that's how we get this value here. However, the reactive power displayed is the right one, so we are at 24 kilovar. We can also display harmonics on the voltage and on the current. Apart from that, we can go in a programming mode here that will allow us to have access to multiple parameters, many of which can be automatically detected by the system if we use the autoconfig feature of the unit. So you can see here the primary and secondary of our current transformer, the number of banks used in the system, their relative correction values, so 1, 2, 2, 2, the control mode and all different types, the value of the smallest capacitor bank, 45 kilovar, and the target KOSFI, target power factor that we want to achieve, 0.95, which is of course programmable. Many other parameters that I will not go through, but just to give you that you have full access and control on the correction that is done by this device. So now if we insert some inductance in our circuit, inductive load, we will see that the power factor has stepped down to 0.905 here. However, the system does not insert any capacitor bank yet in the system, because given the target value that we have programmed in the module, which is 0.95, and given the lowest value of capacitor banks that can be inserted, which in this case here is 45 var, the system evaluates that no banks should be inserted, that we are close enough given the resolution that we asked it to achieve, to that it's nothing is required for the moment. If we increase even more our inductive load, now we drop down to 0.6 as the power factor, and you can see with the two arrows here that the power factor controller considers that some correction is required, and in fact quite a good bit of correction is required because of the two arrows, otherwise it would be a single arrow. So it takes a while, a few seconds to, and this is also configurable in the system, you have to indicate how many seconds before inserting a correction after there was a change in the power factor. Because of course, if you have an application where the power factor changes constantly, you don't want the controller to insert correction too quickly. You want the situation to stabilize before inserting the correction. So this is a parameter that can be set. So now we can see that our controller has inserted the fourth bank, which brings the power factor up to 0.897, which is close enough given again the parameters we have specified. So the controller is satisfied with that. And finally, if I drop my active power, and so that the power factor decreases again, so we can see that again the power factor has dropped to 0.76. And with the little arrow here, the controller warns us that it will insert a new correction after 20 seconds, which is the time that has been configured. So here it inserts bank number one. Why bank number one or two or three or four? Well, it depends on how the system is set up. Each automatic power factor correction system has its own steps of capacitor correction. In our case, we decided to go with one bank at 45 var, which is the lowest value, and three additional banks at twice this value, so 90 var. So typically in the power factor correction systems like this, we will refer to this system as being a 1-2-2-2 system, because the first bank has the unit value, the lowest value, and all the other banks have twice this value. So this is a 1-2-2-2 system, and by adding this 45 var and 90 var correction, we are able to achieve currently a power factor of 0.94, which is really good, really close to our target value. Since we have connected also our data acquisition module in the circuit, so we have a voltage and current input on the source side with E1 and I1, and we have the same voltage and current input on the load side with E2 and I2. So we can see here in our meters that on the source side we have a power factor of oscillating around 0.8, while on the load side the power factor is only of 0.39. So we can definitely see that the power factor correction is done appropriately. We can also see on these meters that the active, reactive, and apparent power on both sides vary accordingly. So now if we make a change on the loads by decreasing, for example, the inductive load, you will see the impact on the power factor on the load side, which has jumped up to 0.5. And currently, the power factor correction module is about to remove a bank of capacitor. Should happen anytime soon. So that now it just removed it, so that we can see that now our new power factor is 0.83 on our LVDAC software. So as you can see, this new course on automatic power factor correction covers practically everything there is to know about on this topic. So from the controller, how to program it, how to commission it, how to connect, how to wire all of the system, the capacitor banks, how they are wired, the different configurations, the different step values that they have to allow precise control, and how when we change the load, the power factor is automatically corrected by the system. The course goes in lots of depth about each of these topics that we didn't have time to cover today. But as you know, and as usual, this course comes with a complete courseware that goes in all these details and allow the students to study them all. So I hope this presentation was of interest to you, and I hope to see you soon in another of these presentations on our electric power technology training system. Thank you.